Becca.
Hi, Jeff. How are you?
Hey, good. How are you? Can you see me, hear me okay?
Yeah, totally. How about you?
Oh, things are awesome. So what do we got? We got 15 minutes. Not a lot of time. Thanks for moving the schedule away. I got T3 this week, so it's crazy.
Perfect. No worries. Okay, so just to give you a little basics of what I've done with my dog, Kodi. I got him at 10 weeks old. From day one, now this was almost 8 years ago. Day one, he had separation anxiety.
Okay.
Got him at 14 weeks into training. Started prong collar training, basic training. That trainer suggested that put him in a do crate.
Yep, absolutely.
We do crate.
Yep.
Also, they suggested doing daycare to help so that he had a pack.
Yep.
That helped get rid of the separation anxiety, but while he was there, he got attacked by five dogs.
Aye, aye, aye.
On two different occasions, and that made him now dog aggressive, which he wasn't before.
Yes.
And I had to basically kind of get on top of him to stop, and it would go on forever and ever. Over a couple years, I got it a little bit better working with the basic trainers, but they said, you know, he's just going to be an anxious dog. You're going to have to just accept him as he is and leave it at that. So then I tried at about age two, I went to a positive reinforcement trainer. They told me that it wasn't that he was attacked, that it was actually the prong collar that was making him reactive.
Right.
So of course that made me feel bad because that's the last thing that I'm trying to do.
Right.
They taught me to use a gentle leader.
Yep, that's fine.
Which I was able to have better control because he's a big dog. He's about 72 pounds
okay.
and I'm like 4'11".
Okay.
So, it didn't remove the aggression, but at least I felt like I had control.
Good.
Until he learned how to get out of it.
Yeah, yeah.
So I went back to prong collar.
Yep.
And over the years, you know, just by working with him and everything else, he got better.
Good.
And then about age, I want to say about five, it started going now not only to dog reactive, but human reactive.
Yeah.
If somebody came in personal space.
Yep.
And of course, I have an anxiety disorder, so every time he reacted.
Yeah.
It affected me.
Sure.
And even the positive reinforcement trainer, and that's kind of when I stopped using them because they weren't helping on multiple levels, but they said that I was causing his, not only did the prong collar cause it, but I was causing his anxiety because of my disorder.
Yeah.
And told that I should maybe consider letting him go and finding him a new owner.
Yeah.
Luckily you had actually, I live on Maui. You came here a couple years ago.
Yep.
My friend Kelly, who was in your class,
recommended
to your videos.
Awesome.
So I got the e-collar and I started using everything. Things again improved.
Good.
More so like he would still be reactive, but instead of it being like ongoing, I would hit the buzzer, the button, and he would stop and look at me like, oh, okay, you didn't want me to do that. But it never made it better.
Got it.
I kind of felt like it was my timing was wrong.
Could be.
I was kind of getting the results, but not 100%.
Okay.
And then he nipped my neighbor, who he knew.
Yep.
About 3 months ago, with a bunch of kids were playing and screaming, and just he went in overload, and I wasn't paying attention
because
I had two dogs in my, you know, in each hand.
Yep, yep.
He did the lunging, and I knew at that point this has to get under control.
Yeah.
So, I actually talked with Michelle.
Yep.
Who you know?
Yeah, I know well. Yep.
Yep. She had me put my hand down lower on the leash.
Yep.
So that it really limited his.
Lungeability, yep.
Yep, and she taught me that, it was my timing that was wrong.
Awesome.
To hit that. Instead of thinking, oh, it needs to be 10, 20 feet away, to the second the tail goes up or the hackles go up or his panting changes, that's when I hit it.
Excellent.
And sure enough, that worked.
Excellent.
So, so I'm stoked about that. So I know I'm on the right track.
Good.
Where now I'm stuck is if I take him to a place that's unfamiliar.
Yep.
In the car, and we go to a Lowe's parking lot or another parking lot or a coffee shop, or if a skateboarder goes by.
Yep.
It's not the same. It's still fear based.
Yes.
Which I know, but it's not. The reaction is tail goes under instead of up.
Yes.
And he becomes almost like a mini Mustang where he wants to run the other way.
Yes.
and my corrections is not helping. It makes him worse.
Okay.
So I know, obviously, I'm not doing something right, which only triggers my anxiety more, which just triggers him more.
Right.
So same issue, fear-based anxiety, but different reaction, and I don't know what to do.
Okay. So first of all, I mean, I wasn't there, but being attacked two separate times by a pack of dogs is going to make a dog leash reactive. This is the way it is. It's going to make a dog, it can actually make a dog aggressive. And the theory is, it's like, I'm going after you before you're going after me. I mean, it makes so much sense in the canine world. It's like, of course you're going to be reactive to dogs. And it's got nothing to do with the prong collar. I mean, we can't reverse time, but put a flat buckle collar on that dog, a harness on that dog, most likely you still would have been reactive. So, you know, it's situational. So, the remote, great. I'm glad you got the advice from Michelle, because that's exactly what I would tell you to do. A lot of times people wait until the dog gets too high of a point. So instead, what do? You correct the dog at the very, very beginning. And if you're working with somebody on your anxiety and you're struggling with your anxiety, I'm sure if it's a therapist is telling you, like, don't wait till the middle of a panic attack and then start doing these exercises and breathing and like whatever. It's like, no, it's like as soon as you feel anxious, like, this is what you need to do. And if you're going to go into an anxious situation, this is what you should be preparing to do. So it's like almost the same thing with dog training. It's like as soon as you start seeing something, like, this dog is such a habit of like doing repetitive nonsense behavior that you know exactly like what this dog's going to do. Like, as soon as that tail goes up, you know, boom, that's when I'm going to say, knock that off. And what you're saying is, you don't care about as much as the tail, because the tail is just a, like, saying, I'm about to be leash reactive. It's just, great, I know where this is going. I need you to stop that. And then you can whisper to the dog. So you can whisper to the dog. If you have to go up high, you have to go up high. Don't worry about the number. Like, pay attention to the dog. So if I say, you know, we don't even need to talk numbers. It's like, use this number. And Jeff, like, that number didn't work. I'm like, well, then go up. And you won't make the dog worse. We've never seen that happen. And we've trained 4,000 dogs. So, you know, always go with what feels right. It's like, I'm walking my dog. My dog is all casual. And all of a sudden, my dog gets alert. Boom. What does it take to get it out of it? Now you're having the opposite problem. You can actually correct fear. Now you can correct fear. What you're correcting is, you're correcting the dog's state of mind. You take away a dog's current state of mind. In a way, it's forced to figure out a more comfortable way. Remember, fear is discomfort. Anxiety is discomfort. So wouldn't it be great for someone to say, you know, hey, Becca, every time you're afraid, I'm going to, I don't know, hey, believe it or not, they use electric stimulation on humans. Unfortunately, they thought it was abusive, even though all the data says it worked. Like, everything from children doing self-mutilation, it was a great experiment, self-mutilation, banging their heads on the walls, hitting their heads. They used low-level electric stim. All of that went away. But a bunch of people said, oh, that's mean. And unfortunately, the parents were like, but it's working. Now they can't do that. So what do? Restraints, medication, helmets. And they've got really big people that can bear hug the kids to make sure they're not hurting themselves. So as far as the fear-based stuff, now what you can do is this. So a couple different theories. You can work on some obedience exercises. And the dog is afraid. The dog is going through fear because for some reason the dog's not trusting that you can get the dog through it. So you've got to prove to the dog that you can get the dog through it. How do you do that? You do it by doing it. If the dog is afraid of, say, skateboards, great. What we're going to do is, instead of being 5, 10, 15, 20 feet of skateboards, what we're going to do is we're going to start out, I don't know, 50 feet, 100 feet, Do you have a skateboard park by you?
Yeah.
Excellent. Yep. There you go. So at what distance do I have to be where my dog starts feeling comfortable, and then all of a sudden I start seeing a change in my dog. I start seeing a change in my dog, and what you can do is call your dog back to you. So your dog's now on a longer line. It's almost like you're gonna be practicing recall. Dog's on a longer line. Dog starts getting close, starts getting nervous. Recall your dog. Does your dog know recall? So recall your dog. You can either recall your dog or you can just slowly turn and move away. You're not running away. You're not quite avoiding because you're eventually going to get closer. So you can and use the remote collar for that. So the dog gets up to the point. The dog is getting nervous. Low-level remote collar. Turn. The dog follows you. What you're doing is you're teaching your dog, technically you're teaching them avoidance right now, but it'll lead into something else. You're teaching your dog that there's another way to deal with this. Just like there was another way to deal with the leash reactivity, there's another way to deal with your anxiety. And and how do you deal with it? Trust me on this one. Just like, I got this. Like, hang out with me. Now, the concept of hanging out with me is, eventually, me is going to be 5 feet away from those skateboards. So the most comfortable place in the world is always going to be next to me. That's the theory. And what do you do is, if a dog tries to flee, when we have a fearful dog and it tries to flee, we correct it. And it sounds so mean. I'm fully aware of the conversation on so many levels. But I don't want underneath that table to be comfortable for you. I don't want you running back into your crate to be comfortable for you, because you might get hit by a car if you're trying to get like somewhere.
Exactly. And that's my concern is I don't want him to run out of fear and get hit and hurt.
The only place that you can be when you are nervous and fearful and afraid is right next to me. That's where I want you to be, for starters. Now, indoor fears, we're going to do something else. We're going to do like the place command, but we're just talking about outside right now in public. It's probably all we're going to have time for anyway. So what it's going to be is like, if you're nervous and if you're afraid, I got this. So I know you're struggling with anxiety. Like, don't you hate when people say, don't be anxious? It's like,
yeah.
Becca, stop being so anxious. It's just like that. It's like, shut up. You don't know what I'm struggling with.
Sometimes I wish that somebody had a collar for me because yeah. I don't realize
I know.
Going from that, and then somebody, I step back and I go, oh, well, that was the wrong choice.
So what you can do is, you can work with a training partner if you want to, and you can videotape yourself. Have somebody videotape you, and you're like, wow, like, I need to work. This is going to be both of your journeys. What I would do is, you're probably being anxious because you know your dog's about to get fearful or leash reactive, therefore you have a reaction for that. It's so common. So are you making your dog anxious or are you reacting to your dog anxious? Are you making your dog leash reactive or are you, we can go around, it's like, which came first, the chicken or the egg? But what we're gonna do is the screen froze. You can see me okay and hear me okay? Okay, good, because the screen froze. So what I want you to do is, I want you to work on these exercises where you start getting closer, the dog feels uncomfortable, remote collar on, move away, verbal praise, good. Not good job, just good, mark it, good. Closer, good. And then every once in a while, I want you to turn away way before the threshold. So you're like, I got up to 20 feet, good. Today, turn away at 30 feet. But Jeff, no, we can do 20 feet. I know you can do 20 feet, but I want this dog to be like, wow, I felt great the whole time. I never got nervous. So mix it up a little bit. And number one, you'll feel confident. The only way for you to get over your anxiety with your dog is for you to have success. That's it.
Okay.
That's it.
Yep.
Give the dog to me. Give the dog to me. Yep. The dog will do fine with me. Big effing deal. I'm a dog trainer. The dog has to do well with you. Because the only way you're going
to... I want to start dog training myself.
Yes.
I actually want to start... I want to come back to the mainland and take courses with you and some other people and actually do it. So like, for example, last week I went to a little shopping center parking lot.
Yes.
Was going to crack him at a coffee shop. When I opened up the back of the door to bring him out, he went tail under and went back to the back of the vehicle.
Yes.
So do I just kind of do the pop on the prong, or do I use the remote to even just get him out of the car? Or
does the dog know recall? Does he know here or come?
Yes.
Okay. Recall.
Okay.
So this is what I want you to do. Stressful place, recall the dog out, put him in a sit, load up, or whatever your command is for getting the car. So come on out, get back in. Come on out, get back in. Come on out, get back in.
Okay.
If he doesn't do it, now you're correcting for lack of obedience. Got it? So now
he knows the difference between that for even though he's in a fear state.
Yeah. Okay. We can't tell the dog not to be afraid, but what we can do is, but I can hold you accountable for lack of obedience. I know you're nervous. I know you're afraid, but I did tell you to come here. And you're not going into a pit of fire. You're coming out into a parking lot. So, but they don't know that. For all they're concerned, it could be a pit of fire. So Recall, load up. Recall, load up. You need to come out of this vehicle when I tell you to, and you need to load up when I tell you to. Now, if the dog wants to rush in the car, what are you gonna do? Are you gonna let him? Nope.
No.
Sit down there. You know, I'm gonna work on some sit stays right now. And you can't, your natural impulse is to go back into that car. Nope, can't do it. I will correct you for doing it because I didn't say load up. This is opposite of advice a lot of people are going to give because they just want you to, like, avoid things. Now, we did talk a little bit about avoidance here because we're talking about distance, but we're also talking about flooding, and I'm a huge advocate of flooding, but also you want to be responsible with your flooding. But all I know is this, we do it all the time. It works for us. We see the results, and I only give people information on something we have done over and over and over again with results. We're out of time, and one more thing I want to say to you, don't you dare not start dog training. Don't wait until this dog is fixed before you start, because I assure you, you are going to work with so many people who are not struggling with this issue with their dog. They're going to have way easier dogs than this. And imagine if you're like, well, how can I train other people's dog because I can't even fix my own? Most people are not going to have these issues. Like walking on a leash and sit and down and place and being quiet in the crate, they're going to struggle with that. And I would hate for your community to not have you as a resource because you're waiting for your dog to be fixed, okay?
Okay, thank you so much.
You're welcome. All right, thanks. All right,
thank you.
Take care. Bye-bye.